This is the BBC Third Programme. We are now broadcasting from the Royal Festival Hall, London, a concert performance of Benjamin Britten's opera Gloriana, which is being given there in honour of the composer's 50th birthday. The work was written 10 years ago for the coronation celebrations. The libretto is by William Plumer. The cast, in order of singing, is as follows. Henry Cuff, a satellite of Essex, Brian Drake, baritone, Robert Devereux, Earl of Essex, Peter Piers, tenor, Charles Blount, Lord Mountjoy, Raymond Herrinks, baritone, Queen Elizabeth I, Sylvia Fisher, soprano, Sir Walter Raleigh, Captain of the Guard, Forbes Robinson, bass, Sir Robert Cecil, Secretary of the Council, Thomas Hemsley, baritone, the Recorder of Norwich, Trevor Anthony, bass baritone, the Spirit of the Mask, Duncan Robertson, tenor, Penelope, Lady Rich, sister to Essex, Jennifer Vivian, soprano, Frances, Countess of Essex, Joan Edwards, contralto, a lady-in-waiting, Barbara Elsie, soprano, the master of ceremonies, Duncan Robertson, tenor, a blind ballad singer, Trevor Anthony, bass baritone, who is accompanied on the guitar by Hector Quine in place of Freddie Phillips. Housewife, Pauline Stevens, mezzo-soprano, city crier, Michael Rippon, baritone, the William Ellis School Boys Choir, conductor Leonhard Prince, the Elizabethan Singers, conductor Louis Halsey, the London Philharmonic Choir, chorus master Frederick Jackson, trumpeters of the Royal Military School of Music, by permission of the Commandant, Polyphonia Symphony Orchestra, leader William Armin. The assistant conductor in Act Two is Stuart Kershaw. The opera, which is directed for the stage by Colin Graham, is conducted by Brian Fairfax. You might like to know that large burst of applause was for the composer Benjamin Britten, who has just arrived in his box. The librettist, William Plumer, has written this introduction. The opera Gloriana is based on historical fact and is concerned with the character of Queen Elizabeth I in the later years of her reign, in particular with her tragic relationship with the Earl of Essex, who was very much younger than herself. The first scene of Act One is laid outside a tilting ground during a tournament. A chorus of spectators is heard cheering their favourite, Lord Mountjoy. Mountjoy unhorses his rival, and the chorus cheer him and acclaim the Queen with a tune called Green Leaves, which recurs later and is always associated with the Queen. When Mountjoy appears, Essex provokes him to a quarrel. They fight, and Essex is slightly wounded. A fanfare of trumpets is heard, heralding the Queen, who demands an explanation of their brawling. Sir Walter Raleigh, who is in attendance, speaks scornfully of the two rivals. The Queen reconciles them, and they protest their allegiance to her in an ensemble. The crowd in chorus acclaim the Queen, again with the tune Green Leaves. Trumpets start a march, and the company moves off in procession. In the second scene, the music begins with a recollection of the fight in the previous scene. The Queen is alone with Sir Robert Cecil, her chief advisor, in a private apartment at Nonsuch. They discuss the unruly character of Essex. Cecil advises caution and talks of the precepts of prudent government. Now a phrase of a few notes conveys here and later an impression of the weight of the Queen's responsibility. Essex is announced and Cecil retires. The Queen asks Essex to take up the lute and sing to her. He sings first lightly and gaily, then more elegiacally to words by the historical Earl of Essex, "Happy were he." An impassioned exchange follows between the Queen and Essex. At its climax, she warns him that they can be overheard by Raleigh. Essex rails against him, pleads for favour, and is gently dismissed. Left alone, the Queen soliloquizes on the conflict of love and her royal duties, and then prays fervently to God.